So first of all, I'd like to say welcome aboard. Thank you very much, everybody, for your time. Today, we'll follow the normal process of our agricultural science policy webinars, where we will offer the floor to our guest speaker, Professor Liggesmeyer. And then he will be followed by Jerome Brandy, followed by Diana Lenzi, and a panel discussion amongst the panelists, after which we will have a Q&A where everybody's invited to send in questions. Please send those for the attention of the panelists. We will organize the questions at this end. We'll have plenty of time for questions and answers. We should have at least half an hour for that. We don't need to take the whole hour, half an hour, but past experience has shown that that's one of the most valuable parts of the webinar. So please don't hold back on your questions. And send them through for the attention of the panelists. This event will be recorded. The reason for that is that the whole webinar will also be put on the internet on our landing page during the course of next week. So if anybody for any reason is not able to participate for the whole event or wants to share it, there will be a resource there so that you can do exactly that. I think at the moment I should first of all, just say how delighted we are as BASF to welcome such a fantastic panel, a wonderful panel with Professor Liggesmeyer as our guest speaker, with Jerome Brandy from CEMA, the Agricultural Machinery Industry Association, and with Diana Lenzi representing the European Council of Young Farmers, or what we call CEJA here in Brussels. So we've got a fantastic panel. I'd like to now just introduce you to Professor Liggesmeyer, who is director of the Fraunhofer Institute for Experimental Software Engineering, known as IESE in Kaiserslautern, where he chairs and has been for some time software engineering dependability in the Department of the Computer Science at the University of Kaiserslautern, and he's been doing that since 2004. Between 2014 and 17, he's managed the affairs of the, and please excuse my pronunciation here, the Gesellschaft für Informatik, or GIEV, which is the German Informatics Society, as president. Professor Liggesmeyer is an author of numerous scientific articles and popular books, and in particular, the standard reference of software quality, which was in its second edition since 2009. Professor Liggesmeyer has also got a long experience of advising politicians, and in particular, the president of the state of Rhineland-Palatinate as a member of the State Council for Digital Development and Culture. And he's also got a lot of experience of advising leading companies in this field. His research interests are safety and dependability analysis techniques, as well as comprehensive security and safety analysis processes for digital ecosystems, and in particular, industry 4.0, medicine and smart rural areas. Professor Liggesmeyer, we're very, very honored to be able to host you as our keynote speaker today. If you'd like to share your presentation, I know you'd like to present some slides, and we're very much looking forward to you telling us about the state of the art of digital agriculture, precision agriculture, and really setting the scene for what I'm sure will be a very fruitful conversation with the panel and with the participants.
Thank you, Paul, for the introduction. I'm also very delighted to have the opportunity to talk to you here at this event about precision agriculture and its advantages for EU farmers. I will try to address this topic from different perspectives, and it's absolutely clear that if you want to precise, you have to have information. So it's totally clear, no precision without information. Well, of course, we see some advantages from our scientific perspective that we expect to arrive with respect to precision farming and digital farming. Of course, first of all, and probably most important, high yields through efficient use of limited resources that comes together with more efficient processes. So the resource utilization is optimized and the processes are optimized as well. But we also expect a better quality control and a direct effect on higher quality products. Of course, sustainability is a very important goal. All of you know the sustainability development goals, and I'm totally convinced that precision farming and digital farming can have a substantial positive effect on many of them. Also, food traceability is a concern. Many people ask themselves, what was the ecological footprint of my food and how was it produced? That is, of course, a gift that comes together with the introduction of digital farming. You can measure certain parameters and you can, of course, propagate them into later production steps when harvest is being turned into food, for example. Also, more comfort for the users, the farmers and their workers, as far as these workers exist, because you usually don't find hundreds of people on a modern farm. So automation, of course, due to the low availability of workforce, is a very positive effect. But we can also see many challenges. I will come to that later. This is our perspective. The question is, do the farmers share this perspective? There is a nice study that was done by Bitkom, an organization in Germany. They asked 500 farmers about different aspects that they would expect to happen. And almost everybody, more than 90% of the farmers, said they expect a positive influence on the environment. Why are saving fertilizers by better crop protection and more efficient resources utilization. They also expect at least the majority, 64%, quality improvements. The same share of farmers is convinced that animal welfare is being improved and cost reduction as well. So the expectations are quite high. Not everybody believes that these positive effects are going to happen, but the majority is convinced. And the question is, why is then digital farming not an ingredient to every farm? So what are the barriers to introduce these things? So we see some challenges. User acceptance, of course. Farming is not a digital domain by nature. And not everybody may accept the existing digital solutions. And the reasons for that might be understandability. So you don't appreciate solutions if you don't understand them. Also, sometimes a questionable benefit. So how could this be evaluated? How can you be sure as a farmer that your investment into a specific digital solution is done right? Also, isolation. We see a very strong fragmentation of the existing solutions. I will also talk about that later more in detail. Trust is a thing, trust in technology. If your workflow is being done with digital means, of course, you would then require that these things run very stable. So reliability, service quality, we have certain challenges. How about the challenges from the societal perspective? Of course, we know that the world's population is growing and that there is a tendency to change eating habits. More and more people eat more meat. And in many regions, not everywhere, but in many regions in the developed countries, we have high quality demands. As a consequence of that, one farmer needs to feed more and more people, which would require a higher yield. That's, of course, a clear requirement. Well, the world's population is growing, and many people find sustainability very important. Also, food traceability is a major requirement. I also mentioned that. So there should be certain influences of that on digital farming. And politicians, of course, share these opinions, especially in the developed nations, in the industrial nations. So there is a demand to use less chemical crop protection, and some of the chemicals are forbidden. There is a requirement to maintain biodiversity, and this together, as a consequence, would cause lower yield as an impact. So there seems to be a contradiction between the requirement for higher yields on the one hand side and an effect that would be a lower yield on the other hand side, which of course produces some pressure on the farmers. And we believe that precision farming can be part of the solution to this contradiction. So the idea is to make sure that we can really achieve high yields in compliance with sustainability targets and a careful use of resources. That's the idea. Well, here you see the sustainability development goals, and I'm convinced that we could together see influences of digital farming on many of these goals, like no hunger, good health, renewable energy, economic growth, responsible consumption, and so on and so on. So almost everything that comes in sustainability is somehow affected, possibly, by digital farming. But it is not only about data. Collecting data is just the starting point. Of course, you cannot get information without data. But if you have data, it is not guaranteed that you draw the right conclusions based on the data. The issue is information. The issue is not data. But of course, the story starts with digital data capture. So we need measurements that have the right precision, for example, and that could be done cheap enough in order to be applied easily. Then, of course, it's necessary to have the data available. Easy availability of data is a major concern which addresses data transport. But the thing starts to pay off here from the third level on, which carries the name visibility. So here the question is, what is happening? Here we start to understand what the data really means. So you get an answer for the question, what is going on here? And the next step here after this is prediction. The question here is, what will happen? Which means I understand the current situation, but I need a prediction for the future in order to make up my mind what to do. So the very last step here is how to react. What we need is a prediction of future scenarios, alternative future scenarios, so that the farmer can make a decision. Say, okay, if I would go with A, this would be the consequence, but I have an alternative B and C, and they have their own consequences. So what should I do? This is where decision support happens and where smart farming really pays off. Well, the status quo doesn't support this because we have this fragmented structure. We have islands of domain ecosystems, like here, a sugar ecosystem of food industry X, which is not attached to the agricultural machinery ecosystem of OEM Y, and the vineyard tillage ecosystem or specialist C. We have solutions for all these domains. Some are influenced by certain vendors, but they are typically islands. So interoperability is clearly a major, major concern. What are important key success factors from a farmer's viewpoint? First of all, balanced digital ecosystems of data and services. What we really would need is a kind of market neutral platform, which is not dominated by a single company, for example, and that provides the service to bring these different platforms together so that we really see a cross-cutting effect. Second, flexibility and freedom of choice for products and services. It must be possible to use the best service provider for every task, and it must be possible to change your mind. Say, okay, I used system X until now, but I would prefer to use system Y in the future. And if it's then impossible to change, obviously the system is not good. So a simple changeover must be possible. Then easy use and accessibility of data, which is a major concern, of course, if these systems come as islands and you cannot transfer data that was collected in system X to system Y. High availability and resilience, of course, offline capability and data synchronization. We don't really have broadband internet in rural areas, at least not in Germany, and this is probably also the case in most other countries, which makes it impossible to directly send data out into the cloud, for example, because you simply have no connectivity. These systems must be able to handle this challenge. So to process data locally or to store it for a while and transfer it later. And of course, security and privacy, data sovereignty is a major concern. The farmer wants to collect data, but he eventually does not want to share it with everybody. So we must have some control over the data. In the Fraunhofer Society, we run a so-called lighthouse project, which I would like to cite here as an example for the same things that I mentioned. We found a very cool acronym as the name of the project. The name is CONJAC, which stands for Cognitive Agriculture, and also for a drink, of course. Well, the system really is an enabling element of these ecosystems. It is the digital platform which is not competing with already existing platforms. It tries to unite them, to make them interoperable. This is the reason why this effort is supported by many companies that offer their own platforms on the market. And it permits the existence of multiple platforms and provides means to make sure that these platforms can work together and can coexist, that you can move the data around and so on. So it shares certain concepts. You are aware about these standards, these international standards like Gaia-X or the International Data Spaces Association, and it's consistent with the technical solutions that are used there. And if you want to read something about it, you can go to this URL and get some more information, just as an example, what digital farming could mean and how such a platform could look like. If we say cognitive agriculture, we mean that we would like to get decision support for agriculture with a digital service that really should be on a human level. So it should be easy to use. It should be provided via a good user interface so that the farmer finds it useful and really appreciates the assistance. We call such digital services cognitive services. As I said, it's not a data service. It is about understanding what the data really means. So it's about cognition. Of course, we think that state-of-the-art technology like AI technologies are a major technical ingredient to these systems in order to draw the right conclusions out of many, many data points. But there are also some challenges for AI technologies. For example, you know that machine learning requires large data sets at a high quality. We usually don't see these many data points in the agricultural domain for a variety of reasons. For example, agriculture has many long-running slow processes, and you don't get many data points due to that. Also, we have many influences that have a negative impact on the quality, many unknowns, influencing factors that may not be available, like high-precision soil parameters. And of course, we have many factors that we can control, like weather and climate. So it's pretty hard to provide data sets for machine learning that cover all these aspects so that the machine learning algorithm would really produce a valid output later on. However, we think there is large potential of getting valuable insight in using these data, and we think that platforms can support these cognitive services by providing methods for assessing data quality or supporting AI training or validation. So this effort has just been started. It is not really mature, but we think it's promising. What will the future be like? Well, the status quo, as I already said, is characterized by a fragmentation, or let's call it segmentation, of the domain ecosystem into a wide variety of digital domain ecosystems. So we have them, but it's necessary to make them interoperable. The current status quo does not permit these analyses that I described previously. There might be bilateral connectivity between systems, but this is not a solution, because you cannot build a connector between every pair of systems. That's, of course, totally impossible. We need a different way to make them interoperable. We have technical barriers, sometimes very simple technical barriers like different formats, sometimes more complicated things like law matters and other things, data usage control, and things like that. And of course, those companies that offer these solutions are usually in a competition with each other. And it's not the case that everybody says we want to share everything with everybody. This is a competitive situation. So we should ask ourselves, when will there be a central platform for mediation between existing solutions? We try to build one, but it's totally unclear whether this will be the solution or another solution would come into life, or we would never see a solution. Of course, there are many advantages. So I believe that there is a certain movement into this direction. When will there be a widely accepted industry standard on data formats and platform interoperability? That doesn't require witchcraft, but it requires that the companies together come to a standard so that interoperability should be easier. When will there be migration path to integrate existing elements into a large agricultural data space? So we are not starting from scratch. There is much machinery out on the field. We already have existing data platforms, and we would need a migration strategy if we really want to make it interoperable. When will there be adoption of new technology, such as ontologies or usage control? So data usage control, to say a few words about that, is a technical solution that provides, let's say, farmers' empowerment with respect to protecting data. So it's possible that the farmer would specify rules that through data usage control would be applied in the case when data is desired to be assessed. And the access then will be granted or it will be denied. So what I say is I see technical solutions for almost every aspect in digital farming, but they come as islands. So it's the interoperability of platforms, which is important, but it's also the interoperability and the integration of specific solutions that already exist. And I'm totally convinced it will be necessary at a European level. National solutions don't really make sense. And this is also one of the reasons why I really appreciate the invitation to give this presentation here. Brussels is the right place to talk about these things. We need a European solution for that. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that comprehensive and thought-provoking overview, Professor Liggesmeyer. That's a wonderful scene setter for our next two speakers. First of all, I'd like to introduce Jerome Brandy, who's Secretary General of CEMA, the European Agricultural Machinery Industry Association. Jerome has been joined CEMA in 2018, following an international career working for a number of companies, and over a period of 27 years, also very active at the association level, including being director of government affairs for Caterpillar, which was, of course, a well-known international company. So, Jerome, we're very delighted to be here with you today. Thank you very much for joining us. And it's entirely natural now, I think, that we hand over the focus to the agricultural machinery industry. And I know you wanted to share a few slides with us.
Thank you, Paul. I hope you can see my screen. Is that working?
Yes, we can see it perfectly.
Yep. Cool. Thank you. And thanks for the invitation. I understand it's lunchtime for many, but that's usually a very great opportunity to exchange views. I also understand I'm stuck between the cognac project we've just heard about and the wonderful wineyards that will come after me with Seja. But my name is Bandry, not Brandy. So I just want to make clear that it's not all around drinking today. So what can we do as advanced farm machinery and solutions on this topic? A few words about CEMA. We are the European Industry Association representing the interest of the agricultural machinery producers in Europe. That's an activity, an industrial activity of about 40 billion euros of turnover every year for a market in Europe around 26 to 28 billion euros. So that already stresses that we have a long tradition and expertise in manufacturing agricultural machinery in Europe and helping to sustainably mechanize agriculture across the globe. With the distribution people, which represent about half of this employment, we have, on top of the 150,000 jobs for distribution, about also 150,000 jobs for the manufacturing of the equipment in Europe. And our stuff goes from seeding to harvesting. So we cover all the different parts of mechanization. And we shouldn't forget also all the mechanization that is used for livestock management, which is a very important sector. And as it was stressed just before me, I mean, the long-term challenges, we all know what they are. We have more and more people to feed. We're going to reach 10 billion people by 2050. But we do have less and less people, at least in Europe, that want to get engaged in farming. I mean, if you just look at the numbers that we have out there, it's about a third of the farm managers, which are in what we call usually in Europe retirement age, 65, right? And only 11% of our EU farm managers are under 40. So that already presents a significant challenge. We also have the very significant challenge of having more and more pressure on the tools we have available in the toolbox in order to do farming. We all know what the very aggressive targets are of the Green Deal, of the Farm to Fork strategy, and all of these. And I'm not here to say it's good or bad, that's not the point, but it's adding some pressure on the way we can do farming. And doing farming is not a single activity. The gamut of different farming activities, different farm size, different conditions in which the farming will be happening is also very, very large. And I think it's clear to everybody that there's not one single silver bullet out there in order to do farming the right way. There's no right way of doing farming. There are many different types of farming. But for sure, we only have one Earth. The certainty we have as the producers of mechanization for agriculture is that mechanization and technology will be part of any solution that we have to put in place. There is absolutely no way, and I think it was made clear in the previous presentation, there's no way we can reach the goals of feeding the global population and also caring for our environment if we're not going to use technology in the different solutions. And you can see this in the evolution of the equipment. Indeed, in the 50s, we had the universal machine that was the workhorse on the farm, virtually doing everything. And then we moved to bigger, faster, wider equipment because of this race for productivity that was typically happening after the Second World War. Now it is more and more smart and connected, and I'll get back to that. And tomorrow, maybe it'll be completely autonomous and guided by artificial intelligence. You already have a lot of equipment that is either available or in development in this field. But you always will have technology. Let me just, for example, point out on conservation agriculture. That's probably the latest development we've been seeing with the turnaround of the century and digitalization coming up. Clearly, we're having cultivation methods that are now further progressing towards conservation agriculture. And we all know what it is. It's three basic principles. You want to have a minimum soil disturbance. You want to have a permanent soil cover maintained all over the year. And you want to have diversity and crop rotation when it comes to what you grow. And I'm not here to say this is the best way or not the best way, but again, however you handle it, if you're going to have to do conventional tillage, minimum tillage, ultra shallow tillage, or no tillage and direct drilling, all this comes with mechanization, and all this comes with solutions, because basically nobody wants to do it by hand anymore, right? And we don't even have the resources that would they be able to do that. But the challenge is here, and that's why we're here today. And it's at two levels. We have the technologies. We're going to have even more technologies, and artificial intelligence is just around the corner. But we have to improve access to smart and precision agricultural technologies, especially for small farm holdings. That's the cue. That's really what we need to look for. Because behind this, what we have, and I really want to stress this, is not buying new equipment or just playing with data. It's creating value. If we lose sight that at the end of all these things, there needs to be value creation for a farmer, for a contractor, for a cooperative, we forget why we're doing this. And if we don't facilitate the access to those basically four families of precision agricultural technologies which we have, which are basically guidance systems, it's what allows you to get in the tractor in the morning, and as a lady told me the other day, my day is over when I get into the tractor, because the tractor knows what it has to do, right? Press a button and off it goes. The second group is the variable rate application technologies. This is with a huge drop in the price of sensors. You can basically tell the machine to only put as much as needed, not an ounce more than what is needed, and to make sure it doesn't go twice on the same location. Farm Management Information Services. This is where you get all the different data, and indeed it needs to be interconnected. Indeed, there needs to be more and more platforms that can talk to each other and all this. But it's making sense and making value out of the information, not the information itself, that will help. And let's not forget precision livestock farming. I mean, this is and maybe it's a dimension I was missing up to now. This is a game changer, a life changer for many farmers, because you don't have to wake up at 4 a.m. to go and milk the animals. I mean, the robot will take care of that, and in a regular and precise and predictable way. So let's not forget that, yes, there's a need for skills, but it's also a life changer for many of the farmers we have out there. And as it was very well said in the previous presentation, you can have all the technologies in the world, you can have all the data in the world, but if you don't have the trust of who owns the data, what can be done with it, do we have a real understanding of what usage will be in there, it's never going to pick up because of this lack of potential trust. And this is why, as an industry, but not just us, not just the manufacturers of equipment, but also the farmers, cooperatives, everybody basically in the chain, fertilizers, producers, all this, we invested more than 2 years of work into this EU code of conduct for data usage in agriculture. Now, it's a living document. It's open for evolutions and all this, because it's a very fast moving area. But it clarifies the following. It sets principles where everybody participating in the code agrees upon, and that can then be reused in contractual arrangements. Because that's probably still the best way to move forward. It's voluntary again. No. We're not forcing anybody to use it, but I would highly encourage you to grab it from the websites of the different participants, preferably ours, to see what's in there and to see the evolutions we've been having. Because again, at the end of the day, it's a question of trust. Now, I'm a lobbyist, so if I talk to EU institutions in Brussels, adding my pitch as to how can we further make this happen, we can make it happen by demonstrating, and we've got a lot of research projects when it comes to that. We can make it happen by showing through contractors the value added of the technology, but as far as we are concerned, it's all about enabling the uptake for these. So we're in the EU, but the real concern, the real push we need to have in the next 5 years, with the modernized CAP, with the different demonstrations we can have, is to enable the uptake of smart precision agricultural technologies. I'll probably stop here, Paul, and happy to answer any question.
Well, thank you for that. I again a very appropriate overview. That's very good linkages to Professor Liggesmeyer's presentation. I think the issues you made about the need for trust and also to demonstrate benefit for each of the different players in the process is really important points. Right now, I'd like to hand over to Deanna and introduce Deanna Lenzi. Very appropriate, Deanna. I'm really delighted to have you here for many reasons. First of all, I think I'm correct in saying this is your first significant public event, having been elected to be president of the European Council of Young Farmers, or as we know, to SEJA. So on behalf of everybody here, I'd like to pass on our heartfelt congratulations. Well done for that. Deanna is a young farmer from Tuscany, where she managed her family winery, growing grapes that make Chianti Classico wines, grow olives for extra virgin olive oil, and produce ancient grains for flour and pasta, including durum wheat. Also, I think of note, Deanna's farm is an organic farm. So we have a young farmer who represents personally an organic business, and then represents the broader young farming community. And as we just heard from Jerome, only 11% of farmers are 40 years and below. I think Professor Liggesmeyer indicated that this availability to interpret data, and Jerome also made the point that understanding and being technologically familiar, and accessibility will be a major issue. So we'd really appreciate your thoughts on that one. And since being joining as president of SACIA, and your background as vice president at the national level in Italy for the National Young Farmers, I think you have a very good basis to contribute to this discussion. So welcome aboard. Thank you again. Maybe you'd like to say a few words about yourself, and then we'll open it up for the debate as a panel. And so feel free to ask each other questions, please. And we're looking forward to having the panel debate for about 20 minutes. For the audience, please take note of your questions, send them to the attention of the panel. We will then, in about 20 minutes, hand over and address your questions, as many as we can, while we still have time available. But over to the panel, and first of all, Diana, you get the first word.
Oh, well, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here today. Yes, it is my first official engagement. So going from representing one farmers organization to 30 farmers organizations is quite incredible. But it's also brought me in these past months to really appreciate the incredible diversity of European farming. And I am very happy that both of my predecessors underlined the importance of a European level solution. I think that if we really want smart farming to be something that will work at European level, we need a smart regulation that can only start at European level. Then, of course, it will have to be implemented at national level, but it all starts in Brussels. So I'm quite happy to have dedicated the next 2 years of my life at breaking my bones in Brussels and making sure that smart regulation is at the base of this implementation system. The great diversity of European farming brings me then always back to my roots and to the fact that, as we said, there is a huge generational problem in Italy and in Europe for the farming sector. If we don't find a way to make farming attractive again, we can't imagine just artificial intelligence running our fields, because one of the things, again, that was said by my predecessors is that we go from data to information, but we can do that process only if we go through interpretation, and interpretation goes to the farmers. It is the farmers who know what that means at farm level. How do I take that piece of information and change my day-to-day activity and make it more efficient? How do I do, as everybody is asking us, more with less? And I think it is through collecting data, but then also allowing the farmer to read through that data and transform it into a decision-making process that we can advance farming. So we definitely need to make also farmers smart. I believe that there is a huge potential with both technology and data. But at this point, it's still at that level where we are discussing it very far away from the reality. It should be mainstream in all school programs for technical institutes of agronomy. It should, because we need smart farm workers, we need smart farm managers, we need smart entrepreneurs in agriculture. We need all of this to be, as I said, absolutely mainstream, the new part of the new programs that people who start looking at the world of agriculture study first, because I hope to not offend anyone, but I'll just relate to my parents. I remember when SMSs, the first messages started coming out on phones, and it seemed to my parents like I was trying to teach them something so above their capability of ever understanding something that simple to me, but it because there were 40 years of age difference. So something that was for me absolutely immediate for them was really hard to grasp. When we went from SMS to WhatsApp, it was another step. Now my parents are on Facebook, Twitter, or whatever, and then sometimes I wish they weren't. But I feel that this same gap is exactly the gap we have right now between smart farming and farmers, because there's a digital kind of gap that we need to close, and we need to close it at school level. So investing in schools, if that can be a starting point to our discussion.
That's a fascinating perspective. And I have to say, I feel for the challenge that the young farmers have, as somebody who's also, I would say, rather technophobic when it comes to digital equipment. So I'm always happy that we have three boys who can sort problems out when we have technological issues. And I suspect it's the same in farming families as well. So at this point, I'd just like to open it out to the panelists. Maybe Professor Liggesmeyer, you wanted to contribute, as you have, you were the last one to do so, and then come back to you, Jerome, and we'll have a discussion between the three of you, if that's possible. So, can we hear you, Professor Liggesmeyer? Are you on mute, or?
All right, can you repeat the question? I didn't get it.
So we're just giving you the chance to respond to what you've heard from Jerome, from Diana.
Okay, yeah, right. I pretty much share these opinions. I think we have a completely consistent opinion about the necessary steps. I pretty much appreciate the position that training the farmers is absolutely necessary in order to make smart farming happen. What I want to see is smart farming together with smart farmers. We see very often when we try to introduce technical solutions that it doesn't really work when you hand it over to untrained people. And it's absolutely necessary that you also transmit the right skills if you want to make a technology innovation, if you really want to make it happen. So congratulations. I pretty much share your opinions, colleagues.
Okay, so it sounds like we may well have a lot of agreement here, which is not always the best thing for a discussion. I've got some questions prepared, but I think Jerome, maybe you just like to either add to the agreement or fire a question to your fellow panelists.
Yeah, thanks. I would definitely agree. Maybe just one extra dimension. It's a real very interesting and fast evolution that we're saying. I'm a bit hesitant about revolution, because revolution is maybe something else, but the speed with which we're seeing new developments is very interesting. So there is indeed this whole dimension of how fast can the full chain digest that information, make sense out of it, and really have some value added, because again, that's what we're after at the end of the process. But it also creates a situation where you have many new entrants, including very interesting perspectives, but also people that you would otherwise not have expected in the area of agriculture. And I didn't put this slide for today, but it's very interesting to see how many players you had in the ag support activities just a couple of decades ago, and the huge amount of new entrants that you have. And it raises to me also the question that if we lose sight of this creation of value, long relationship with the different players based on trust, that we may indeed could also have some solutions looking for a problem to fix, which is not what you want. We want again to have better solutions out there that help the farmers and the contractors to move towards sustainable farming even more than today, and in the end feed people in a safe way. And the best proof we had of that is just what we just went through, and that we're currently unfortunately still going through, is this big resilience test that we had with COVID. Because, you know, okay, we're all talking to a camera here, but there's no teleworking for farming. You have to be in the fields and do what needs to be done at the right time, because nature wouldn't just go on pause and say, well, come back in a month, right? So we just saw a whole chain being able to be resilient and deliver. I think we should spend a little bit of time also in looking into how much of that was made possible because of the progresses we had with all those new digital tools. I mean, just in our own little field, we had service technicians that could talk to farmers and ask the farmers to do things on the machines that otherwise we would never ask the farmers to do, because it's basically the knowledge of the owner of the producer of the machinery. But because there was a connection, because there was data that we could jointly agree to use, some maintenance could actually be done in remote. Well, that's part of the resilience. Could we have done that in the past? I'm not sure. Can we do it better tomorrow? Certainly. But let's not forget that dimension.
I think that's a very good challenge.
Do you want to comment? Yeah. I'd love to, because I can so relate to that, on the fact that really we were kind of in a moment where we were somehow stranded, but for some reason our life kept on looking as normal or as usual. It wasn't normal, it was just as usual, but at the same time we were finding new ways to like also read through the information that we were getting. I had an example of coming from actually South Africa of a wine cooperative that started short supplying because they couldn't go through the normal supply chain of restaurants, private clients, but used a system to collect the data to put the private client directly in contact with the type of supplier that he more desired, and they built a market out of nothing in 3 months that managed to back everything that they were losing out of their normal revenue, which is it's fascinating to see how with so little we can often do so much. Also, sometimes we have the opposite problem. I have my president of my association who has an automated machinery that, because the satellite doesn't read correctly the boundary, he needs to stop mechanically right before the boundary, because the boundary is a cliff and otherwise his beautiful machinery would end up off the cliff. So we still are in that phase where I think there's the light, there's the dark, and there's the gray in the middle. But with the advancement that we're seeing, I'm pretty sure that sooner or later everything will slowly move back into the light. And in the light, what we really need to also bring in is that connection with civil society. I did not start there just out of case. I believe that also that great gap that there is between farmers and consumers, which are at the two ends of this value chain, but kind of feel like they're always playing on opposite teams, can be closed, because we're not playing on opposite teams. Farmers work for consumers. We work to put food on their plate. Anything that you eat that isn't only processed or comes, or even the most processed food in the end or in the beginning was something that a farmer farmed. And I believe that data and that also capability through new technologies in a few years to really kind of let the dimension of the farmer into the communication with the consumer is something that will help us close that gap, that trust. I see many possibilities. Maybe I'm a visionary in a more highly sophisticated way of labeling, a labeling that isn't physical, but it is the collection of data that the consumer can read into as the story of the product, and that there make an informed decision, because we have now a labeling system that doesn't inform, it just creates often confusion. Well, instead, behind every product, there's a story to be told. And I think that is what the consumer really wants to hear. He wants to know, what am I eating? And if it's good for me, why is it good for me or not? Rather than a percentage in some things. So also there, I think the smart regulation will have to go into that direction, into allowing this huge abundance of information that we're slowly collecting to come in service of civil society, and not just to create more teams and confusion.
That's maybe I could just pick up on that little point if I may. Living here and working in Brussels, and I'm sure Jerome will have noticed the same thing, that there has tended over the last one or two decades to be an increasing polarization between the technophiles, the ones who want to see technological innovation, whether it's GM or seed novel seed breeding, and the more technophobic lobby here, which wants to keep things as traditional as possible. And I think you represent a sector with organic farming, but interestingly, I would say has been associated with a relatively high level of skepticism about biological technologies. But you're obviously very enthusiastic about the role that digital innovation can make. And I mean, to which extent is that, do you feel that's characteristic of the whole organic sector? And to which extent is that a group within the organic sector, perhaps, dare I say it, younger, more technologically enthusiastic farmers within that sector? What, maybe you could comment on that. How receptive are farmers going to be from different age groups and from different backgrounds, whether they're smallholders, large farmers, or even organic versus conventional? Could you maybe shed some light on that?
I tend to be a very democratic person, and I think that the world works only because we allow room for everyone, and everyone is allowed and entitled to be heard and accepted. So that's my take. I also have a very critical take on organic farming, in the sense that I believe that the regulation could be improved so much, and that organic farming does not mean sustainability in any way. And I actually believe that if we want organic farming to be sustainable, we can only do it by applying technologies that can help us use the least amount of product necessary on each plot, which is not what I can do at legal level here in Italy. I have a quantity of product I need to put per hectare, and it's often way more than what I would ever want to use. So I kind of corrupt my books backwards, which nobody ever heard, because I don't believe in waste or in adding residual to the soil that is unnecessary. So this is the other thing. This technology is something I would love to be able to implement on my farm, but at this moment is absolutely inaccessible financially for me. And as a young farmer, if I go to the bank and ask for credit, it's very hard for me to get credit in order to implement this type of technology, which is the third level of smartness I would like to see in farmers, is also to have those financial skills that make them think of what a good investment is and how I can access the tools that I need to be able to make that investment then economically sustainable, which is something that we're missing as a class, let's say. Conventional farming can be often, when done with that precision, with that efficiency, I think much more sustainable than a classic organic farming system, which is why we kind of need all of it. I believe that in certain regions, for example, new and improved plant varietals will be the solution, because organic farming will not be a solution because of climatic conditions. In some regions, organic farming done in a more sustainable way, I think really we need to accept the fact that Europe is a patchwork. It's polyedric, it's versatile, it's many things, and it's the beauty of European farming. I would dread having my role in the United States.
That's a really fascinating perspective, and thank you for being so open with us. I just want to remind everybody, we have got the possibility for questions. You can submit your questions for the attention of panelists, but whilst you're thinking of your questions, I just want to hand it back to Professor Liggesmeyer and to Jerome Bandry. Do you have anything you would like to react to Diana's comments there?
Maybe just quickly on the uptake, and I see there's a question also in the chat along those lines. Is you know, how can you help making smart farming accessible to all farmers? And this question of the bank, you know, knocking on the door of bank saying, here's my investment plan, can you support? Well, yeah, it is really a challenge. One thing we're seeing that works actually quite well is in the first years when we're thinking about a new approach using new machinery and systems for a farm operation is to go with contractors that have the latest technology and that can actually come and demonstrate. And because, I mean, indeed, farming is not something, you know, you try a new solution on Monday, and if it doesn't work on Tuesday, Wednesday, you just change and go back to the previous day. No, you need to really have a good thinking about, will I make a transition and where and how with what space. The leverage of contractors with the latest technology, or just having a neighbor that's actually using the technology, you can see how, if it works or not. We found that as a very practical way in convincing people to make the investment and to move. That's one key thing. One additional space, and we touched on it very briefly. There's a number of things that the public authorities can also do overall, and I'll just take two extremes here. One is, well, okay, I'm a bit old now, but I was never told in school how things grow. I mean, we missed that basic knowledge that no, chickens don't have 6 legs because they come in packs of 6, you know. I mean, you mentioned the US, that's a story coming from the US, and I lived it. But basic education, right? Of what it takes to grow things and how that works. At the end, other end of that spectrum, public authorities must and should further invest into broadband capacity in rural areas. Because you can have the smartest machine, if it's sitting in the middle of a field that has no connection, that's it, right? Can you hear me now? So if we don't have access to those digital tools by the infrastructure that supports a strong and steady signal all over Europe, especially in the areas where we want to do farming, not only it will improve the life of the inhabitants in those small communities to make them smart villages, I think that's the theme we're using more and more, but it has a whole implication also on the ability to bring in the new digital technologies in our rural communities where we need it.
Well, yes, I could also make a short comment. I think that obviously there is not the one size fits all solution of smart farming, which would be the best one for every farm on the one hand side. On the other hand side, I'm convinced that there are some aspects that would be beneficial for every farm. So my expectation would be you have to be careful to set up the thing in the right way. And nevertheless, a digital divide will exist. And the introduction of these things may take some time. It will not happen on every farm within the next 5 years or so. But I'm convinced that we will see a tendency to implement more and more smart farming technology worldwide. That's totally clear because we have some pressure to do so.
Maybe you could just pick up on a comment I think you all 3 of you've made, you've touched on, which is the relationship between smart farming, sustainability and environmental emissions. You know, within the context of the Green Deal with the farm to fork, the ambitions Europe has to become environmentally sustainable, maybe you could be a little bit more specific about which technologies, which smart farming technologies you feel have most to offer in this context. What is the benefit, particularly for the environment, of these new technologies, and maybe also, well, you know, what could get in its way? Maybe we could start with you, Jerome, please.
Sure. Well, how long do you have? Because I mean, there's a lot of stuff happening. But if I make it ultra simple, what precision farming brings to you, and to have precision farming, you need to have smart applications supporting that, is that you minimize as much as possible what you will add into the ground. That's, if there's one thing to remember, that's it. So if there needs to be support for one plant in one area, ideally, if you push precision farming to the end, only that plant will receive the support that is needed. Now, when you add to this developments like on the machine itself, you can do different operations at the same time, which is the ultimate goal also of conservation agriculture. If you think of a field where previously the normal method would have been tillage, and then you go again, and then you go again, and then, instead of having 10 passes, whatever, if you have a machine that can actually do seeding, fertilizing, a little bit of tillage at the same time and everything, so those direct drillers that we now have, of course, it doesn't work for everybody. Of course, you need to have the right conditions to do that. But it's a complete revolution also, because you really push the disturbance of the soil to the minimum. Now, this can be applied in many, many areas. But for example, in some vineyards, mechanical weeding, so using new devices that will be so precise that you know exactly where the plant that you need to keep is, and it almost recognizes the plant that you need to get rid of, and it's only that one that is removed. That type of precision you could never have in the past. So that's what we currently have. The point is making value out of it, value added, and enabling the uptake of those technologies. That was just at the level of the machine, but the real value is the integration of all those data points into a full system that then still gives the farmer the decision of what to do, when to do it, and how to do it, but brings in what used to be in the little black notebook from 3 generations that, you know, if this, do that, that suddenly becomes part of a new ecosystem that brings new capacities, new capabilities, new information points to the farmer in the decision. Will we have fully automated farms tomorrow? Maybe not in my lifetime, maybe we will, I don't know. I personally still like the little human touch that we have in some of the operations, and but we also have to accept there will be different types of farming out there that will be present at the same time, because we still have the challenge at the end to feed all the population that we have. Can we feed all that population just on what one type of farming that is the best we want maybe in this part of the world? I'm not sure. So how do we make sure all those technologies can work together, types of farming can work together, so that we have what the mission of farming is, feeding people?
Thank you, Jerome. I'm sure we should have another follow-up session specifically on all the actual specific technological possibilities. But in the meantime, Professor Liggesmeyer and Diana, would you like to comment on
share just because we're talking a lot about how this makes us more efficient, which is something that of course is absolutely fundamental and also is very demand driven, both at farm level, but also at society level. But also another thing, it's the story of what we're doing here with an association of producers, how actually this type of information and technology can help us also in market choices, in targeting, for example, our products. We've been using sensors on 20 farms that all live in the district of Castelnuovo Berardenga, this small township around Siena, to study how on 3 different types of soil that we've identified, Sangiovese as a single variety grows differently, even if we are kind of under the same climatic conditions, following exactly the same growing season. So we analyze through the sensors the maturity, both of the grape, but also of the leaf. So the healthiness of the leaf and then of the grape and the maturity of the grape. We then use a protocol to vinify exactly in the same way this single plot. And then we compare the wines, because this is helping us then know the famous human touch to use our then human senses to see how by having a uniform data and a protocol, we're seeing how the soil reacts and how the environment reacts and how us winemakers would say the terroir reacts inside the wine. And it's helping us make decisions on how we present these wines, and especially in how we present our district of producers of Chianti Classico to the world as a unique territory with its differences, with science base behind it, that turns into a product with an added value that also comes from this story. So yes, it is all about production and making our productive systems more efficient and more sustainable. But I think also there is so much potential in how we then, as I said, we use this data also to reach out to the rest of the world that is still, we're kind of at the tip of the iceberg, I believe.
That's very interesting that you see it not so much within the context then of specifically productivity and sustainability, but also the relationship with the consumer. Professor Liggesmeyer, did you want to react to that key question?
Yeah, it might also be that the way how we implement smart farming has some effect on the machinery that we will use. We can ask ourselves, well, the tendency of the past to produce larger and heavier machines really will be the future. I'm not convinced about that. I know many equipment producers that do research on autonomous field robots that are somehow much lighter, so lightweighted equipment that are more flexible and that have a positive influence, for example, on soil compaction. So it is absolutely clear that we see many aspects within smart farming and especially within precision farming, which have this positive effect on the environment. That's totally clear.
Okay, so look, we've explored that very central point. I'd just like to ask you a very naive question. I've often heard the phrase smart farming. Is there such a thing as an accepted definition? Are there do's and don'ts of how to use that phrase?
Yeah, it is. As always, if the term is a little bit complex so that it has a variety of aspects, you don't come up with a single definition. I can give you one from my perspective, but I'm not convinced that everybody would share this opinion. I would define it as, let's say, the use of IT and automation in order to improve a variety of aspects within farming. And this variety could be aspects that already were mentioned, like sustainability, new business models, and many more things. And that might be the source of the confusion. So everybody picks his or her favorite aspect and takes this and uses it to define the term. But it has many, many facets. But if I would have to say it in a single sentence, I would probably use this one.
That leaves a lot of options open, I have to say.
Yeah.
Diana, Jerome, would you contest that definition or add to it?
Well, I wouldn't contest, but I would probably, I mean, personally, I don't really like the term smart farming because it also carries the idea that there is another type of farming that is not smart, which I would really challenge. Smarter farming might have been better call, but I don't have a smarter phone. I have a smartphone. That's, I guess, the trend that we're seeing. But I used to love my stupid phone because it did a lot of things much simpler way than my new smartphone will do. So I guess behind it, it's all about precision agriculture, and it's bringing the digital dimension and the value added that you can have by the integration of data. All this is made possible because, I mean, there's always been data coming out of machines, for example. It just wasn't used the same way as it is now. And don't get me wrong, there's data and data. There is data that the machine itself would generate for the functioning of the data. And this is why this code is so important. I mean, if you press a pedal and it's data telling that means you're turning right or turning left or braking before the cliff or accelerating because you're at the beginning of the field, that's data that one needs to be super protected and you know, be shelled against any intrusion or whatever, because there's a lot of stupid things you can do with a big agricultural machine or even with a small agricultural machine. Just think about data breaches with potential, you know, cyber attacks. If you're doing your harvest and you do it the wrong way because the data was compromised, then it also has a huge impact. So there's a part of data that really needs to be not available and fully protected because it operates But the part of data where you can make value out of it by bringing it with other data and combining it and helping with the decision making and so on, or the type of data that allows you, and again, it's zeros and ones, but using those zeros and ones to say, wait a minute, you sprayed already on that plant, you don't need to come back to it, which we turn into, well, you have 24 sprayers, just cut 1, 3, and 4. And keep 2 and the rest, right? So that's the type of usage of data that precision farming will bring to you. So there's a lot behind smart farming, but yeah, the term itself I don't really like.
I just had a warning, my battery's running out. That's interesting. Deanna, did you want to comment on the definition before we go on to one final question?
No, I would absolutely second everything that was said, but if we need smart farming, as I said, we need smart farmers in a smart environment with a smart regulation. So that would kind of be my putting at least a perimeter into what we define smart farming.
I like the fact that you've included the smart regulation in there as part of the definition. I really think that is smart, by the way. But now for not a very smart question, but I hope we'll get some inspired answers. We only have 10 or so minutes left before we start wrapping up. I'd like to ask you if you could do one thing, if I could wave my magic wand and give you one wish related to smart farming, digital precision agriculture, and how it can contribute to Europe to achieving the objectives of the farm to fork of the Green Deal. I just appreciate very, very short, very succinct from each of you, what would your biggest wish be? And I'll start with the order we spoke with. So, Professor Liggesmeyer, if you could go first, please.
I would pick the interoperability of the equipment and the various platforms. So I think we really need to integrate the current solutions in order to make it happen. That will not be the complete approach to smart farming, of course, but without integration, nothing will work.
That was very succinct and very clear. Thank you. Jerome.
Thank you. Yeah, if I had to put it in just one sentence, it will be my last slide. It's enable the uptake of the solutions. And the reason for that is that at the end of the chain, we must create values and our farmers are facing global competition. So if we don't allow European farmers to take advantage of the digital farming, smart farming applications that we have available and are coming up, it is in the end the competitiveness of our farmers and our place in the world that is potentially challenged. Enable the uptake.
Okay, thank you. That's the point about global competitiveness. Deanna, last word for you.
I would agree on economically accessible for young farmers, for farmers who are no building up their farm from scratch or taking over the family farm and trying to put it in a modern era in a global dimension and see the benefit, like the potential benefit of this type of both technology and data use for their own vision of their farm and have the possibility to actually implement it. Because as I said, we have instruments that tend to try to help farmers in like their setup, first installation aid, co-financing on investments. But then sometimes we get so lost in the bureaucracy of it that you just tend to even not get your hands mixed up in that, because it takes up so much of your time to just go through the paperwork that in the end, it's easier to go and get the whole grant from the bank, which we know is hard. So when I mean that it needs to be accessible, I mean, really, there should be an enabling system that, of course, starts from the regulatory system and then to the financial system. I know this is very modern technology, which has very high costs, but the first iPhone used to cost, if I remember correctly, 1,200 euros. Now you can get an iPhone for 300. Maybe we can imagine that slowly there will be an economic scaling that can make it more accessible to young farmers, but there can also be instruments that can make it more accessible to young farmers. So promoting aggregation, or as it was said, to also facilitate the use of contractors and making it accessible economically through there. And can I just answer quickly to a Q&A that is in the chat box? Because I understand the concern on labor, but labor right now in agriculture is hard to find. It's hard to find workers. It's hard to find farm workers. And I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we are still very, in a way, behind in using this technology. And this technology will also always need the human factor. So I truly believe that in advancing this type of technology, we will advance a new workforce at farm level, which is why I did not leave the farm workers at all out of it. I think they are the first people who need to be guided into understanding this type of technology and that can use it at farm level for the farm manager, because there's roles and space for everyone if this were a productive sector that really kind of rewards the farmer and the farm workers economically.
So that if I take some, just if I could possibly summarize, the big wishes are interoperability, integration, enable European farmers to actually uptake these technologies to policy level, to make sure that they're economically accessible to all farmers, especially young farmers. I think that's a very powerful message. We really appreciate your contributions throughout the whole of this webinar and indeed for preparing for it. I'd like to take this moment to thank everybody who's dialed in and followed the webinar as well, by the way. It's always a pleasure to host the agricultural science policy webinars. If anything, I would say this panel has been guilty of too much reasonableness and agreement. But thank you for that. That really has made a very useful basis for conversations. I'd also like to thank my colleagues, particularly Andrea Boccuni, for doing so much work in preparing the webinar. And I'd just like to also remind everybody that this webinar will be available as a complete recording on our web page, on our landing page, this time within a week. If you have any suggestions or ideas that you think would be useful that you would like us to organize a webinar around, please feel free to get in touch with us. We're always looking forward to good ideas, particularly to expose the technologies and sciences underpinning current policy making discussions. So with that, I would like to thank you all again very much, and especially our expert panel for your time, and draw this webinar to a close.
Thank you.
And have a great weekend. And for those of you who are going to be watching Italy against England on Sunday night, may the best team win.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
BASF. We create chemistry.